there, folks, and a very big welcome back. Now, today's episode is especially for the cat lovers amongst us. And you might recall in last week's episode, we talked about babesiosis, and we said it was a real threat during the summer months and to be on the lookout for it. Now, while it is most common in dogs, we certainly also see babesiosis in cats, so do please bear that in mind. But today's episode is more specifically about an infectious condition which is uniquely found in cats. And this condition is called feline infectious anemia. Now, your vet might refer to it as feline mycoplasmosis or even feline hemobartonellosis. That was the previous name until it was changed. Now, feline infectious anemia is infectious, as the name suggests, and your cat can pick up this condition by being bitten by an insect. That might be a flea, a tick, or even a mosquito. And when they are bitten by one of these arthropods, the parasite, which is a mycoplasma, is injected into the bloodstream, and it attaches to the red blood cells of your cat's blood, and it can be transported around the body in this fashion. Now, if your cat is very well and strong and fit, then there's a very good chance that his or her immune system will deal with it very well all on its own, and there won't be any symptoms of disease. However, we tend to see this more often when your cat is a little bit down. You know, he or she might be a little bit immunocompromised for one or other reason. Perhaps he's dealing with another ailment, or he's stressed for any other reason, and then his immune system isn't able to deal with the infection quite as effectively. And in this case, it results in the red blood cells being taken out of the bloodstream by your cat's spleen. And if sufficient numbers of red blood cells are infected, it can result in anemia. Now, the incubation period, that's the period between being bitten by this by one of these parasites and actually showing the symptoms, can be quite long. It can be several weeks. But when your cat does show symptoms, they are, for example, a general depression. You know, it might be fairly vague in terms of your cat just not eating the way he or she normally would, and they may even lose weight. They may well have a fever. Whether you take your cat's temperature or your vet does, the temperature may spike. And they certainly might be pale if you check their gums. In more advanced cases, they may even be jaundiced. And so, while they're fairly vague symptoms, if your cat is looking like he or she just is weak and tired and hanging around and not eating the way that they usually would, well then, you know, you really don't want to delay, and you want to get your cat down to the vet as soon as possible. Now, the good news is it can be quite easily diagnosed with a blood smear. It's quite a small parasite, so you may even want to specifically ask your vet to look out for this one, because it can be overlooked. And there are cycles prevalence of the parasite in the bloodstream, so it can also be missed, and sometimes even a repeat blood smear is needed. But when it is diagnosed, the good news is it can be treated easily, and of course always the earlier the better, and your vet will choose a specific antibiotic for this parasite, and it in most cases responds very quickly and effectively. In more advanced cases, or if your cat is compromised for other reasons, he might need additional supportive care like fluids or even a blood transfusion, although that's a lot more uncommon. So that is feline infectious anemia in a nutshell. Of course, prevention is always better than cure. So the emphasis is on trying to prevent infection, infestation with fleas or with ticks, even keeping mosquitoes away so that the chance of your beloved feline friend being bitten in the first place is reduced to a minimum. So that's feline infectious anemia for you. I hope you found that helpful. And until next week, have an amazing week. Bye bye for now.